Hey, all you cool cats, ready for a little fun? That's what I thought.
Pop Talk! Scooby-Doo-Wah-Doo-Wah, Pop Talk! The fun never stops, you know, Pop Talk! If you're a nerd or a jock, run, don't just walk. You're ready to rock, you got Pop Talk!
Now, from Funko Hollywood, it's time for Pop Talk!
Hey everybody, this is your pal Funmaker Mike, of course, with special edition of Pop Talk today. We have guitarist Jerry Cantrell, of course, and he's right there.
I'm right here.
And then, of course, we have our friend drummer Sean Kinney.
Yeah, we are Alice in Chains. Yeah, right there.
So you're from Seattle, I hear.
Yes, thereabouts.
Yes.
Yeah.
Did you ever play Pierce 70?
No, we weren't old enough.
I don't think we.
That was a top 40.
What?
To us, we were not of age to play there by the time they were not having bands. And by the time they had bands that may have been still playing there, they were bands that played more popular music and not music for dirty, unwashed youth ourselves.
As a matter of fact, a few of us were not quite 21 when we played a few bars, and Sean's dad, who was a cop at the time, had to kind of walk us in.
Lane, we would put him, when we play places, in one of my drum cases and bring him in a bass drum case,
because right.
He was under 21 to get in. Otherwise, a lot of the time they'd catch him and he'd have to stay outside till we'd play and he'd walk right on stage. We had just turned 21, but when we started, we weren't all of age.
Hollywood Underground, remember that?
Yes, we did play there.
That was one of our first gigs,
I think. We played there.
Yeah.
There was no stage. You played on the black and white checkered floor.
The Central?
Of course. The Vogue was we were kind of like the house band at the Vogue.
The Vogue
for
and
a
the
while.
Central were.
God, that's in chance. Here. I had all these things ready to go. The Vogue, the Central. We were, this was our big moment. We were playing for an AR guy from Atlantic, and we were playing at the Central. I go running across the stage. I was a bass player. And somehow there was a little nail sticking up.
Oh.
And it caught my shoe, and I went completely straight down. And
I started catch it with your hands or anything, just bass?
No, I started kind of pretending like I was doing push-ups. I just thought, that's
nice
the
save.
Best save.
Sweet save.
Just as the bass is going, dong, dong, dong. Well, this is perfect segue to my next question, because after that show, he said, and this is, I think, 88, 89, somewhere right in, it might have been 88. He says, you guys are the best looking band, the best sounding band we've ever heard. He goes, but we're not signing bands like this anymore. He goes, we just dropped a band called ABC, and that was like our heroes. We thought ABC was the greatest band in the world.
Okay.
He goes, there's this new sound that we're signing out of Seattle.
Kind of uglier is what we're going for, yeah.
Extremely amateurish.
So we fit the bill.
And washed.
Yeah, we fit the bill.
It says right here, were you aware that
they have some sort of angst issues and daddy issues and... We want to go with that for the masses, because you know what? Why not?
It says right here, were you aware that you destroyed a perfectly good 80s new wave band?
We are not.
Right at the height of their career.
We are not. We've been told by plenty of people,
because
we're all in the same business, and we've been told, you know, from people that were, especially in this, we're in Los Angeles, right, in this town, you know, the rock and roll was huge, and they had a huge scene, and I've had a lot of those people from that scene that are popular and famous over the years, you know, roll up on you as you get to know them and be like, you wrecked our lives. I'm like, you're giving us a lot of credit for that, you know?
Yeah, too much credit.
Yeah, there's too much credit for that, you know?
All right, well, let's do some stuff here that gets back to Funko, okay? Can we?
Yeah.
Back to the actual
reason.
That's what we're here for, man.
We're not here to memory lane on our
You guys start building any kind of pop you want. Just build some fun. It can be you, it can be alter ego, you can be anything. There's no wrong answers here. Just have some fun and enjoy yourselves. Pick from all the pieces here.
Okay, so you got legs, torsos.
Yeah, just have fun with it. And as I continue to hit you with these hardball questions,
all right,
you can build a pop.
Okay.
All right.
I'm down with that. I didn't know we got to do something like that.
You know, we are
this
a collectibles
is an interesting
company.
Technique. So you like you kind of like.
Oh, that's what you do.
Yeah, we're a collectibles. Do you collect anything?
Motorcycles.
Oh yeah. What is, you know? Here's a question.
He's got about 20.
What is a collection? More than two? Because if it's more than two, I get a lot of collections. If it's like if there's a number, what do you think? You're in the collectible biz. What do you think?
I'd say,
what is it? At 10?
I'd say four.
Is there a number? Jerry says
it's somewhere between 16 and 17 from what our data is showing.
Okay, 16 to 17. See, that's what I said. You're in the collectible
bit. A little more sparse.
So they're not, I'd collect a few things, motorcycles. Ridiculously have probably.
And is it have to be a Harley? Does it have to be?
I have them all.
He's got it everything.
I like them all.
Wow. And do you store those anywhere in particular?
I have a building I store them in. I hang out with them. I talk to them for 2 years during COVID.
Yeah.
I ride them around.
Wow. Well, hey, that's a neat thing to collect. So are they more like in a certain area, like 50s, 60s, 70s?
They're all over the place. It's whatever I just like, you know. So I've had a lot of custom ones made, and there's ones you can actually travel around on and take things with you. There's ones that are really cool looking that are uncomfortable. There's functional ones, you know. So about every brand you can think of, at whatever, you know, different eras, from the 70s to, you know, I've had one from the 50s to. I just bought a new one, and I'm embarrassed to say it, right before I left to go on this tour, because I guess I collect them.
Yeah.
Jerry, do you collect anything?
Not really. I mean, I guess unintentionally, there are a lot of my cohorts that guitar player buddies of mine are probably more avid collectors of cool collectible guitars, but you can't do this for 35 years without collecting some guitars. I probably have about 100. So it's always amazing to me coming back from every time we get together to play again, because you go down to the rehearsal place where all our gear is stored, and you look at the wall of all of the guitars that you have, and every once in a while I'll actually open the cases, forget what you have, you know. Oh my God, I didn't know I had this. Kind of funny.
It's not a wall, by the way. It's an entire room.
It's an entire
room.
Just
guitars.
It's actually three or four rooms with all of our stuff.
I have two rooms of drums. You just end up with way too much. Is what happens. Like over there, if you stick around long enough, and people let you stick around, and they like your songs.
Yeah, so probably guitars.
Yeah, you just end
up
with a
bunch. Let's name two influences that you really feel, like band-wise, like really, I don't know, changed your life, made you want to do what you do, what I think I wished I could have done. But hey, you know, who cares?
What is it
I
for you?
I got Funko. No.
What is it for you?
For me, my influences?
Yeah,
I would say Cheap Trick, I would say Rush. In a weird way, I would say like Depeche Mode and Duran Duran.
Okay.
I'm a big Duran Duran fan. Yeah. I'm not a really big, surprise, a super rock metal guy.
Yeah.
I'm not. I was like U2, the classics, Beatles, and a lot of other. I mean, I love all of it. That was never my. You know, I'm not super uber. You know, metal or die kind of guy. I love all of it. So that's kind of a. I'll agree with that.
It's hard to pick just two, but if I got to pick two, I'd probably go AC/DC and Black Sabbath.
Yeah. What about guitar sounds? Like when you hear the guitar sound of, like, I don't know, a band like Boston. It's, like, you know it's Boston.
Yeah. This is the cool thing about being a musician is that, you know, there is a variety of, like, gear that everybody plays, but it's not really that big, but the individuality of the person still comes through. For instance, you know, Tom Scholz is a great one. There's nobody that sounds like that. Eddie Van Halen, Tony Iommi, you know, I mean, you can line all three of those guys up with the same amp and the same guitar, and they're all going to sound exactly like themselves.
Some of the greatest players you could get in a room, and they're great, and you can always play, but it just doesn't have that, you know. It's like
I think gear is a really small part of the portion of what you sound like. It's more you.
Yeah.
Remember, you'd have to play sets. Remember, you'd play like three sets a night. This is back. I wasn't playing these stadiums.
You know?
I was the '80s band that you guys knocked out, so we were just playing sets.
We all found our place, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we all ended up here. See?
Making pop dolls of you guys.
Which is awesome, by the way.
It's pretty great.
That is, to me, honestly, I'm not even lying about it. That's probably one of the coolest things.
I have a few of these in my office. I've got Elton John, I got Richard Sherman, I got Russell Wilson, I think I got Marshawn Lynch.
Yeah. Yeah, this to me kind of, I know it sounds weird, but
you guys,
to me, it feels like,
you guys
did
made some
right.
of us.
Yeah, we did something right.
Yeah. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, this isn't something when you
Thank
play
you,
music you think would be is any in the realm of something.
All right, well, it's cool that you guys are officially part of the Funko family and you are popped.
Thanks for including us. We appreciate it.
How many full bands have you done those?
Like these, what we call Pop Deluxe, we have not made a lot. We've made AC/DC.
Metallica, gotta be.
Yeah, Kiss.
Yep. Kiss.
So you're right up there with...
Holy wow.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks, dude.
That is a huge honor.
Yeah, it's actually a big deal.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Is it because we're from the same state? Come on, come clean.
Yeah, part of it is. I'm trying to think of any of those. Do you guys remember, places to eat? Do you remember 13 Coins?
Of course.
Of course.
Do you remember the Doghouse?
Of course.
Okay, do you actually like Dick's Burgers?
You know what?
I don't.
I do a guilty little revisit on those every once in a while, and I feel sick, but it's an enjoyable 20 minutes followed by a couple hours of distress.
Yeah. I've never really dug it.
Yeah, just don't wear those shorts.
Yeah. I've never really dug it, but I get it,
Yeah.
And you got to love a place that'll sell you a bag of You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You gotta love that.
Yeah, that's always good. All right, these are some questions from our friends at Loudwire.
Okay.
All right.
More of a fan of medium wire, but I've aged, so.
Number one, which of Alice's music videos was the most fun to shoot and why?
The videos are kind of not fun to shoot.
I am not the guy to say that. That is my least favorite thing. What we do.
I think down in a hole for me because we all came up with the idea to have the little
Super 8
thing, so we all kind of shot parts of the video and
drop here to
you. And we didn't fake our tune. We didn't, rock.
Yeah.
We just kind of hung out and went out to the desert to this crazy desert community with just a ton of desert rat people.
I'll agree with that too. Nothing was planned. We gave ourselves Super 8 cameras.
Yeah.
Got weird in the desert.
That's a great video.
Film stuff, and I'll agree with that. That was the only one. That is the only one that wasn't. That is my least favorite thing to do.
What was your favorite quirky hairstyle or outfit that Lane had at any point?
I think pink hair was pretty good, but I think my favorite is the Wurzel Gummidge. I think he just didn't brush his hair for a couple of weeks, and then he started to develop dreads, and then he kind of regretted it, but he hung on to it.
He hung on to it early in the thing, and so
hung on to it.
Had these kind of gnarly, ugly, dirty dreads, and then we'd go up and like open a beer and get a beer bottle cap, and I'd squeeze it into his hair.
Yeah.
After a while, his hair was just like
a collection of stuff in his hair.
Collection of crap.
We would
just kind of crimp into his wig, and then he'd keep that going.
When was the moment that you realized your band made the big leagues? Was there a moment where you guys, holy shit, we did it, we made it? Was there a certain venue, certain sales, like maybe in an album?
It was probably Clash of the Titans. We'd been touring Facelift for about 8 months, and we've been playing little kind of clubs and opening up for. Like Iggy Pop, and I think our first band we opened up for on that tour was Extreme, and we were kind of just slugging it out in clubs and stuff, and we got asked to be a part of the Clash of the Titans with Anthrax, Megadeth, and Slayer. The first half of that was pretty brutal, and we kind of really enjoyed that part of it because people were throwing shit all the time and booing us and stuff, and we liked to throw back. And in the middle of that tour, that's when radio and MTV and it all kind of clicked and hit. The Man in the Box kind of hit in the middle of that tour. I remember what it was before, and then I remember it changed, and you could, that song took off, and then people stopped throwing
Everybody liked you now. The guys that hated you 2 weeks ago and wanted to fight in the parking lot now wanted to take a, you know, drink a beer and tell
take
you that you're great.
With a paper box camera.
Yeah, yeah, you know. They wanted to hang out with you. And then you realize that's, you know, the power of MTV.
We're going to get back to something called rapid fire fun.
Rapid fire fun.
Should I just, I'm just going to go back and forth.
Go back
Fair
and
enough.
Forth.
Favorite movie of all time?
Oh, God.
That's too hard. Favorites are hard.
The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly.
That's a nice one. If you were a superhero, what would your superpower be?
I'll just simple, fly. I could fly. I don't have to.
I like it.
I don't have to take my shoes off at the airport.
I back that.
Favorite cartoon growing up as a kid?
Roadrunner.
Yeah, the Looney Tunes. Yep. Hey, you remember the one, what was it called? It was One Froggy Evening. And this dude is demolishing, it's a Looney Tunes, Warner Bros. Looney, he's demolishing a building, they come across a little time capsule, opens a box, it's like in the 30s or something, and a frog jumps out with a top hat and starts singing, hello my baby, hello my darling, and he sings all the time, but he's trying to make money, he sees money, he says, I'm gonna make money, and he f***ing takes the frog, and it won't do it in front of anybody else, but
just
he's always singing around
in front of him.
He takes all his money, and he gets the theater, and he invests everything, and the frog stiffs him, and everything goes to and he loses everything. So he takes the frog back because they're rebuilding the building he was demolishing, puts it in a time capsule, and then at the end, like a guy like in a spacesuit demolishing the building, finds a time capsule, opens the box, frog jumps out and sings. That's my favorite cartoon.
That frog became the spokesperson for WB somewhere in the 90s for a little while.
So that's the same frog?
We're going to do both. Favorite breakfast cereal growing up?
Cocoa Puffs.
I didn't get a lot of sweets because I'm annoying and high strung. So I have to say something lame like Raisin Bran with a ton of sugar on it, right? So much there'd be a sludge of them on the bottom of it.
Each one of you tell us a band that would surprise your fans that you're into.
I could say anything.
You can take this one.
I could say Casey and the Sunshine Band or disco I like a lot of disco shit. I like a lot of everything, whatever, you know.
I think I've said it before, so it's not really a shock. The Bee Gees.
Best, most memorable gift you ever got as a kid?
My mom and dad both gave me my first acoustic guitar, so I was, probably early teens. My mom gave me a little Spanish guitar, and then I went to live with my dad in Pennsylvania, and he gave me a little acoustic guitar as well. Yeah.
Steel strings?
No, it was like plastic strings still.
Both Spanish?
Yeah.
Classical ones? I think when I got my first, like, real drum set, because I'd beat on everything and have the little kiddie ones. It was pretty early on. It was my grandfather's band's drummer got a drum set, a newer one, like a Pearl one, and he had an old Ludwig one, which I wish I still had. It had skin heads on it, skin heads, like the 1930s thing, and you clip the on. Had a painting of like a mountain all on the front, like seriously, like an old big man thing. And he gave me that drum set, and I was like, you know, I'm five or whatever, I don't know. Have it out in the garage. I'm putting plastic garbage cans up to try to make more drums and whatever. And I ended up like standing on the bass drum and breaking it and all this stuff when I was a little kid. I regret that. But that was the coolest thing because it was like, it felt like an adult, you know, it was an adult, gave you an adult thing. And he gave me this speech about how to respect it and I f***ing didn't. But that was important.
Oh, all right. Well, if you had one word that you had to define yourself by, just one word, what would it be? Okay.
Thankful. Thankful.
Are you
well,
gonna
that's two words.
A good word.
No, it's one word.
Yeah.
Thankful is one word.
Is a solid word. I'm gonna
that
stick
is a solid.
All right. Well, we're gonna. I think we might end on that.
Word of our dolls.
All right.
Let's talk about that. Jerry? Sean?
I just threw a little, little platinum blonde dreads on there, but, you know, it's football season, so I kind of dressed him in Seahawks colors, and he's got a football in his hand. We're rebuilding.
That's Ned Schnibbley. He's a substitute teacher. He lives alone. He's underpaid. He gets no respect from anybody. He has a cat. The cat hides under the bed, and he has no relationship with it. And it's Cat's probably going to be 22 years old.
23.
He's going to feed it. He cleans the cat box. There's no reason for it to avoid him, but it does. And that's Ned.
Okay, well, that's a perfect way to end Pod Talk with Allison Chains. My friends, thank you guys
for
being here.
Thank you so much, man. Yeah. It's so nice to meet you.
Take care, and let's go out and shop the store and have some real fun.
Cool, man. Right. Thank you.
Take care, everyone.